Welcome to this service from the Angus, Dundee and Perthshire Circuit. We're glad you have joined with us today and hope you find rest, peace and fulfilment in our worship. My name is Julia Walsh and I am leading worship today, and Keith Pearson is leading our prayers. Come, everyone who is thirsty. Come, the lost and the seekers. Come, the lonely and the welcomers. Come, the sad and the comforters. Come, the empty and the generous. Come as you are, with your questions and beliefs. Come and drink at the well of living water. Come and worship the living God. Let us pray. Lord, we are drawn to your well to seek the water of eternal life. Refresh us with your word, surround us with your love, and fill us to overflowing with your spirit, the water of life, that we may never be thirsty. Amen.
Let us pray. Father God, you are almighty and all-knowing. You planned the course of our lives for each of us. Thank you for your care of us and for the gifts you have given to us as individuals. Help us to use them well as we seek to live to please you. Lord Jesus, when you were on earth, you showed love towards those who followed you, but you also made demands on their lives. You do not expect us to sit back as your disciples and wait for everything to come to us. Help us to live life to the full, as you did, and to know that you understand when we go through the hard times. Holy Spirit, you have been present at every important event in history. Thank you that you have shown us Jesus and that he has given us the gift of the Spirit to be with us always. Just as you led Jesus in the desert, help us to see you at work as we allow you to lead us and show us the way to go. Holy God, three in one, we worship you with our lips. We pray that we may also worship you with our lives in the week ahead. God, who calls us on the journey of Lent, forgive us when we've been so wrapped up with the beginning of our journey of faith that we failed to let it flourish and grow. God, who gives us the journey of Lent, forgive us when we have been so comforted by your affirmation and love for us that we have failed to share that love with others. God, who calls us on the journey of Lent, forgive us when we have been so caught up with the day-to-day challenges of our own lives that we have failed to live lives of justice and peace. God, who calls us on the journey of Lent, forgive us when we've been so excited to hear the good news for ourselves that we have failed to be good news for the people around us. Forgive us and challenge us. Send us out to forgive others and to be the change you want to see in our communities and our world. Amen.
And we shall live. A Samaritan woman came to draw some water.
Give me a drink of water.
His disciples had gone into town to buy food.
You're a Jew and I'm a Samaritan. So how can you ask me for a drink?
Jews will not use the same cups and bowls that Samaritans use.
If you only knew what God gives, and who it is that is asking you for a drink, you would ask him. And he would give you a life-giving water.
Sir, you don't have a bucket and the well is deep. Where would you get that life-giving water? It was our ancestor Jacob who gave us this well. He and his children and his flocks all drank from it. You don't claim to be greater than Jacob, do you?
Those who drink this water will get thirsty again. But those who drink the water that I will give them will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give them will become in them a spring, which will provide them with life-giving water and give them eternal life.
Sir, give me that water. Then I will never be thirsty again. Nor will I have to come here to draw water.
Go and call your husband and come back.
I don't have a husband.
You are right when you say you don't have a husband. You've been married to five men, and the man you live with now is not really your husband. You have told me the truth.
I see you are a prophet, sir. My Samaritan ancestors worshipped God on this mountain. But you Jews say that Jerusalem is the place where we should worship God.
Believe me, woman. The time will come when people will not worship the Father either on this mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans do not really know whom you worship. But we Jews know whom we worship, because it is from the Jews that salvation comes. But the time is coming, and is already here, when by the power of God's Spirit, people will worship the Father as he really is, offering him the true worship that he wants. God is Spirit, and only by the power of his Spirit can people worship him as he really is.
I know that the Messiah will come. And when he comes, he will tell us everything.
I am he. I who am talking with you.
At that moment, Jesus' disciples returned, and they were greatly surprised to find him talking with a woman. But none of them said to her, "What do you want?" or asked him, "Why are you talking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the town.
Come and see the man who told me everything I've ever done. Could he be the Messiah?
So they left the town and went to Jesus. In the meantime, the disciples were begging Jesus, "Teacher, have something to eat." But he answered,
"I have food to eat that you know nothing about."
So the disciples started asking among themselves, "Could somebody have brought him food?"
"My food is to obey the will of the one who sent me and to finish the work he gave me to do. You have a saying, 4 more months and then the harvest. But I tell you, take a good look at the fields. The crops are now ripe and ready to be harvested. The one who reaps the harvest is being paid and gathers the crops for eternal life. So the one who plants and the one who reaps will be glad together. For the saying is true, someone plants, someone else reaps. I have sent you to reap the harvest in a field where you did not work. Others work there, and you profit from their work."
Many of the Samaritans in that town believed in Jesus because the woman had said, "He told me everything I have ever done." So when the Samaritans came to him, they begged him to stay with them. And Jesus stayed there 2 days. Many more believed because of his message, and they told the woman, "We believe now, not because of what you said, but because we ourselves have heard him. And we know that he really is the Savior of the world." After spending 2 days there, Jesus left and went to Galilee, for he himself had said, "Prophets are not respected in their own country."
Reading is taken from Romans chapter 5, reading from verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation.
How do you explain? How do you describe a love that goes from east to west and runs as deep as it is wide? You know all our hopes, Lord, you know all our fears. Words could not express the love we feel, but we long for you to hear. So listen to our heart, hear our spirit sing a song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. Words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. But when words are not enough to tell you of our love, just listen to our hearts. If words could fall like rain from these lips of mine, if I had a thousand years, I would still run out of time. So if you listen to my heart, every beat will say, thank you for the life, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. Listen to our heart,
oh Lord, please listen.
Hear our spirit sing,
and hear us sing
a song of praise that flows,
a song of praise
from those you have redeemed,
those you have redeemed.
And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God. But when words are not enough to tell you of our love, just listen to our hearts. Listen to my heart. heartbeat will say, thank you for the light, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. And listen to our heart,
oh Lord, please listen.
Hear our spirit sing,
and hear us sing.
A song of praise that flows,
a song that flows
from those you have redeemed. Are not enough to tell you of our love, just listen to our hearts. When words are not enough to tell you of our love, just listen to our hearts. Listen to our heart,
oh Lord, please listen.
Listen to our heart.
I don't know about you, but when I saw what the reading was today, my heart sank. It's one of those very complicated and many-faceted readings, not to mention long. It's like one of those conversations that you expect the big players in corporate bodies or politicians introducing new bills to have, because every sentence is fraught with meaning, every word double-edged, verbal fencing with insinuations and hidden messages, and no one actually seems to say what they mean. Well, I'm no expert, but there's no way that I could even attempt to sum up what is being said here in its entirety. But it is important that we read this passage in the context in which it was written. Although the author is no longer absolutely believed to be either John the Baptist or John the Apostle, this gospel was first known around 115 AD. Its sources appear to be from a variety of people, including early Jewish Christians from Galilee and Judea, former followers of John the Baptist and Samaritan converts, a very mixed bag, much like the church today. It's believed to have been written in response to pressing questions from the community at that time, and it's an attempt to communicate the truth of the gospel to Christians in need of help. John's community didn't need more information about Jesus. They had plenty of that. What they needed was discussion about what they knew and clarification through authoritative interpretation of it. They needed assurances that Jesus was God's representative and could act on their behalf. It was aimed at producing faith in Jesus as Christ and Son of God, a fulfillment of all the messianic hopes of the Jewish people. And because it was never meant to be an autobiography, it doesn't contain the teachings of Jesus in parables like the synoptic gospels of Matthew, Mark and Luke do. John's gospel is about dialogue and discourse, or talking, and that's something that comes naturally to us. So what of the dialogue between Jesus and the woman at the well? It would have been a bit of a shocker to early Christians, still trying to come to terms with this strange and different way of living their life. I can't believe that they would all find it easy to change their preconceived ideas and ingrained practices. So I wonder how they felt about the fact that Jesus overcame two prejudices of the day. Firstly, conversation with a Samaritan because of the deep hatred between Samaritans and Jews who'd had a falling out. And secondly, conversation with a woman, any woman. The fact that he was talking with someone in both categories must have gone down really well. But as we know now, Jesus accepted, loved, and welcomed everyone long before the word inclusiveness was invented. And what of her, this unnamed woman, minding her own business, collecting water from the well which had been there from Jacob's time? Probably not impressed with life because of the long walk every time she needed more water, especially at the hottest part of the day. We're told that she was probably a social outcast, and it's hinted that she was a prostitute, because women simply didn't visit the well on their own. It was a gossip shop, a place to catch up on the news, to share information and glad tidings, a noisy social place, a sort of early version of the Scottish steamy. But she was alone. We're also told that she'd had five husbands and was living with a man that she wasn't married to. How did that happen? I don't know about you, but I get really frustrated at times because I dearly love to know more about these bit players in the Bible, their lives and their history. But that's never going to happen. And that's not what my focus should be on. So she arrives at the well. She finds a dusty and tired Jesus sitting there. I wonder, when he speaks to her, does she think he's like all the other men she's known? Has he heard of her reputation? What does he want from her? He appears to be very human at that point, with no indication of who he really is. But she's still very polite to him. She reminds him of the differences between their people, and that they can't or won't share drinking vessels, and that he has no way of drawing water or a cup, thinking that'll shut him up. And suddenly they're having one of those double-edged conversations. Even when he tells her that he will give her life-giving water, although it's apparent by now that he has no way of drawing water from the well, she still remains polite. But perhaps she's beginning to think, who is this madman? And it's only when he starts to talk to her about her life that she starts to recognise his importance. You're a prophet. The conversation then goes deeper and talks of the difference in their ways of worship, mountain versus Jerusalem. But Jesus tells her that it will all change. There will be a new way of worshipping and salvation through the power of God's Spirit. And she reminds him, but the Messiah will tell us everything when he comes. And Jesus says, I am he. What a statement. Could there ever be anything more frightening and amazing to be faced with? Jesus said, I am the Messiah, and I will give you life-giving water. Wow. Water, especially if you live in a hot, arid country, is a luxury. Something to be eked out as if it was liquid gold. As if each drop was likely to be the last you get, as sometimes it may be. Even here in Bulgaria, due to climate change and the lack of winter rain and snow, some villages are already really struggling, and water is being rationed. Wars have been fought over water supplies, not just in the spaghetti westerns where beef ranchers need to have it for their stock. So no wonder the woman at the well wanted to take up Jesus's offer. Water's a blessing, but it can also be a curse. Too little and you suffer and die. Too much and you can suffer and die, just differently. All you have to do is look at the flood and drought situations across the world right now and in the last year to see what's happening because of water. And there are many among us who are old enough to remember the devastating scenes from Banda Aceh in 2004, East Asia. A small place that in normal circumstances none of us would have heard of. And then there's the earthquake-generated tsunami in Japan in 2011. Such power, such destructive force. No wonder I have a very healthy respect for the sea. I'll happily admit that despite being qualified as a scuba diver, I'm just a little bit afraid each time I dive into the water. And the day that that fear and the edge it produces disappears, I'll hang my fins up, despite the fact I love the sea in all its aspects. But many people don't realise its power. When I was on holiday in Mallorca one year, I went diving to a small cave. The weather was moody, and when we got to the dive site, the waves were crashing up the small cliffs we had to jump off. And I must admit to feeling a bit queasy about the whole thing. When we jumped, we had to time it right, because if you caught the wave at its highest point, the drop was only about 3 metres. But if you timed it wrong, then the sea dropped away and you plummeted about 10 metres into what was then shallow water and onto rocks. And I do this for pleasure. One of the group had only ever dived in the UK, in quarries, in Stillwater. She had no experience with the sea and simply didn't know how to handle the constantly changing environment, despite being well qualified to dive. And she needed assistance and air from our dive guide. Her astonishment and awe at the power of living water was very apparent. But water isn't always a majestic and powerful force. It can also be a slow, relentless force which can change and create many things. Whilst a steadily dripping tap gets on our nerves and requires a fairly urgent solution, that same steady drip over many years, carrying lime deposits, unseen and unheard, changes the world by creating stunning stalactites and stalagmites in caves like the one I spoke of. Water is something we cannot live without. Our bodies are made up on average of 66% of water. We can live days without food, but without clean water, we die very quickly. It's a life-giving force. We thrive and flourish if we are watered, as all living things do. And Jesus is offering us all living water. And sometimes when we accept it, it will change our lives with the force of a tidal wave. Nothing is ever the same again. Sometimes our lives seem better afterwards. But sometimes too, we think, did I really agree to this? Because when the penny finally drops for us, as it did for the Samaritan woman, and we truly understand that he is the Messiah, our salvation and our source of life, then we have to be prepared for whatever may happen. It changes our lives. Now that may be in huge, overpowering ways, as I've mentioned, or it may be in the slow, relentless, unseen ways, where we aren't even aware that we're changing on a day-to-day basis. And you know what? We don't have to walk long distances in the hot sun. We don't have to labour to carry buckets for miles just to survive, or even to lose everything in floods. We just have to recognise Jesus now as the Messiah and our Saviour, take him into our lives, open our hearts, and let the Spirit do God's work, just as the Samaritan woman did. Even with her almost certainly dodgy past, she's the first person to whom Jesus discloses that he is the Messiah. And she's actually the first person to bring others to believe in him, because she quickly grasps the importance of what he's saying and rushes to tell her compatriots. She is an effective missionary to her own people, as they believe her even before they've heard from Jesus himself. And her transformation becomes the transformation of the whole community. There are no outsiders. As Paul says in Romans chapter 5, because we stand in grace and because we are reconciled to God through the death of Jesus on the cross, if we keep faith, we will find God's peace and will be given the strength to live our lives as he would have us do, welcoming and sharing the wonderful news of Jesus with everyone, rather than avoiding certain people that we see as difficult or somehow less worthy. We, like the Samaritan woman, have been renewed by the Spirit of the living water and need to let the world know that this is freely available to everyone. None of us are outside God's love, no matter what our past or what mistakes we may have made. We are all God's children.
This goes out to every outcast, to the just don't quite fit in. Every wrong way, runaway rebel, so ashamed of where you've been. This goes out to every searcher, trying to fill that empty space. Well, your searching days are over now, everything's about to change. Come and join the Jesus people. This is where your heart belongs.
We join together in our prayers of intercession. We pray for places around the world where there is no fresh water, for places that suffer constant drought, or where people have to walk miles to the nearest well. Water of life, quench us with your life-giving spirit and bring hope. We pray for those on the margins of society because of their status, age, disability, background or race. Those who seem to have no voice. Help us to hear their cries, to listen to their pleas, Help us to open our eyes and our ears. Water of life, quench us with your life-giving spirit and bring hope. The Samaritan woman took a risk speaking to Jesus. We pray for all who take risks on a daily basis, in their jobs, for mere survival, to get food and water for their families, and for children involved in risky situations all over the world trying to survive. Water of life, quench us with your life-giving spirit and bring help. We pray for those in our communities who need your water of life, those who are lonely, bereaved, sad, or have lost all hope. Bring them your comfort, joy, and peace. Water of life, quench us with your life-giving spirit and bring hope. Amen. We join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We long for our uniting. cross proclaiming and one creed reciting, one in the truth of Jesus and his word. So lead us on till toil and trouble ending, one church triumphant, one new song shall sing to praise his glory.
Thank you, Lord, that we are accepted. Thank you that we belong. Thank you that you give us the water of life to drink. Help us to be accepting of others and invite them to drink your water too. Amen. Thank you for sharing worship with us today. We hope you enjoyed being with us and we hope you will join us again. Take care. Bye.